is Hope Today, and we are so pleased to welcome you once again as we share together in this time of biblical teaching and music. It is really good to be with you. Pastor Tom Cullen is leading us to discover the truths of creation as recorded in Genesis. Pastor Tom, it is impossible to miss God's ingenuity, His creativity, and His artistic design in all that He made in this world. When we look into the night sky, we just cannot fathom the size of it all. But when we look at the history of mankind on the earth, the question really is, why did God make us?
That's a great question, Brian, and one we'll address on today's program. I think that one of the many truths that Genesis 1 teaches us is that God did not need to create us at all. If you read the ancient creation myths from Babylon, you'll discover the gods whining about how much work it is to look after the earth. So they create humans to do work they don't want to do and provide them with food. But Genesis 1 paints a completely different picture of creation. We see a living God who doesn't need us, but we need Him. According to Scripture, He provides for all our needs, even our need for salvation. Here's We the Kingdom with God So Love.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Well, come all you sinners, come find His mercy, come to the table, He will satisfy. Taste of
There's a wonderful verse in Psalm 145 that states, "All your works praise you, Lord." And is it any wonder? God is great. He's majestic. He's awesome and righteous. But more than all this, Scripture says, "The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made." Let's join with Kortnie Heying and sing, "Holy, Holy, Holy."
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to Thee. Holy, 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 mercy.
For the last number of weeks, we've been examining the opening chapter of the book of Genesis. It's a wonderful poem in which we learn that God is the Almighty God, above and beyond creation and worthy of our worship. But the question arises, why did God create us and the world? Several answers present themselves. There are some who say that God was needy. He couldn't live without us. But Genesis 1 teaches us that God did not need to create us at all. In fact, it's clear from history that that is a pagan idea. If you read the early Middle Eastern creation myths, as I mentioned earlier, you'll discover that the gods got tired of looking after the earth. So they created humanity to bear the yoke of caring for the earth and providing them with food. This is why the ancient faiths of the Near East are big on ritual. It was believed that through the ritual, you were providing for the gods and seeking to keep them happy. Those religions were driven by fear and self-preservation. Now think how revolutionary Genesis chapter 1 is. It tells us that God creates humanity not because he needed humanity to serve him and get him food, not at all. In fact, the exact opposite is true. God is the one who provides food for all his creatures, including his human creatures, and does so so abundantly, so wonderfully, that they are able to rest from their labors on the seventh day. This is revolutionary. Do you recognize God as the one who provides for all your needs? He truly is the one in whom we live and move and have our being. Jadon Lavik sings the truth in My Father's World.
This is my father's world. To my listening ears, all nature sings and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in the thought of rocks, of trees, of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. Oh, and let me never forget that though the wrong seems often so strong, God is the ruler, yeah. This is my Father's word. Oh, the battle is not done. 'Cause Jesus who died will be satisfied, and earth and heaven will be one. 'Cause Jesus who died will be satisfied.
God didn't create us because he needed us to serve him. The New Testament book of Acts, chapter 17, verses 24 and 25 says, "The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else." Nor did God create the world and humanity because of some deficiency in his character or defect in his thinking. Creation did not make God a better God or improve his character. He is self-sufficient, complete, and flawless, without any defect or deficiency in himself. Genesis 1 teaches us that God is intimately involved in creation and with his creation, but he is beyond creation. He doesn't need us. Just think of the implications of this for a moment. Since God is self-sufficient, it means that you're of worth to him simply because you are, not because of what you do. This is great news, because now you're free from striving and trying to win God's attention and favor. You can rest from all that and obey him because you have his attention and favor. Further, since God is self-sufficient, it means your salvation doesn't depend on you. If God needed you to fulfill something that was lacking in his personality, what would happen when you failed? He would drop you as soon as you were unfaithful. And we're unfaithful a lot. We're sinners, and our relationship with God is ruined. But thanks be to God, our salvation doesn't depend on us. And so we read in the New Testament book of Ephesians, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved." Here's Matt Redman with "The Praise Is Yours."
Infinite, self-existent, beyond the end, before beginning, eternal one, Creator God, you made the world and it was good. All in all, self-sufficient, so high above, but never distant, made for your love, fashioned from dust, you gave us breath and it was good. Glory and honor, blessing and power, because your name alone is worthy, worthy forever, the praise is yours. We hid our face, separate, our glory faded, went our own way, gave up on love, but you would not, for you
all the praise is yours. You won't share your glory with another. All your people sing.
We've been asking the question, why did God create humanity? One of the reasons that is often suggested is that God was lonely. He needed someone to love, so he fashioned humanity out of the dust. But if you read Genesis 1 carefully, you discover that God exists as a Trinity. Chapter 1, verse 1 tells us that God is present. Verse 2 tells us that the Spirit is present, hovering over the waters. In the rest of the verses, we read a phrase repeated over and over again. And God said. That's how God creates. He speaks, and it is created. Now think about it. What is different from God's word and our word? If we say, let there be light, what happens? Nothing. You have to go over and switch on the light or clap your hands. But when God says, let there be light, there is light. Why? Because God's word is an agent. God's word has agency. It has a power in and of itself. When we turn the pages of our Bible over to the New Testament book of John, chapter 1, we read, "In the beginning was the Word." And then it is made clear in verse 14 that the Word is Jesus Christ. And we read in John chapter 1, verse 3, that through the Word, through Jesus Christ, all things were made, and without Him nothing was made that has been made. So put those two texts together, Genesis 1 and John 1, and we see that the reason that the Father's Word is able to create, that His Word can actually do, is because the Word of God is a person. God is a Trinity. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Why does He create? It's not because He's lonely. He's a Trinity. He's not lonely. It's not because He needs love. He has love in the Trinity. The reason He creates is because He has a desire to share that love and demonstrate that love, that community, and that glory. Sandra McCraken sings of the mystery of the three in one in Trinity Song.
Holy Father, Son, and Spirit, Holy Communion, three in one. Holy Father, Son, and Spirit, Holy Communion, three in one. Peace. your feet with your invitation, finally communion, free in one. Come with your feet with your invitation, finally communion, free in one. Holy Father, Son, and Spirit, Holy Father, Son, and Spirit, Son and Spirit, three in one, three in one.
Why did God create humanity? St. Augustine suggests that the world was created because a triune God, God who is one in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, delighted in each other's being for all eternity, pouring out love to one another, and one day said, "Let's expand the circle. Let's expand the community. Let's create beings that can be part of the circle." That's why God created us. Think of it this way. There are two couples standing in front of us. There is a dysfunctional couple and a healthy, well-adjusted couple. The dysfunctional couple says, "Let's have children so they can love us and serve us. Let's have children so we can boss them around and get praise from them for our success." This couple is motivated purely from selfish motives. But the functional couple says, "We have so much love that we want to share it. Let's have babies who will look like us, have our life within them, and whom we will love and will be given the chance to love like us. Then they can enjoy a close relationship with us." This couple is motivated by unselfish love. So when God says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, "Let us make mankind in our image," he is saying, as a Trinity, we have an abundance of love. Let's share it. Let's create humanity in our image so they can love like us and enjoy a relationship with us. You know, the Bible defines love as not being self-seeking. This is a definition of God's love toward you and me. He didn't create you because he needs your love. He created you out of love and for love and with great joy. Do you know that? When God created you, he created you out of joyful love. Let that sink in, and you'll be singing and dancing and worshiping with new energy. God created you with great joy, and there isn't a day when he regrets that he made you. Here's Keith and Kristyn Getty with "Creation Sings the Father's Song."
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. And flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning globe, he charts the eagle's flight, commands the newborn baby's cry. Whose blameless life would break the curse, whose death would set us free to live with him. eternally. Christ shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars, the rage, are birth pains of a coming age. When he renews the land and sky, all heaven will sing and earth reply. With one resplendent theme, the glories of our God and
God created humanity, God created you, out of love. Unfortunately, humanity has rejected that love and rebelled against Him. But thanks be to God, He continues to love us. He loves us to such a degree that John 3:16 says that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So even after we reject His love, He offers it again in His perfect Son, Jesus Christ. When we believe in Jesus Christ as our Savior, we are born again and called children of God, able to reflect His image to all around us. The truth of creation is underlined by the truth of Christ dying on the cross for your sin and mine. God loves you. Rest in that truth. He loves you not for what you do or what you have done, but simply because you are. Yes, you are broken by sin, but through faith in Jesus Christ, you are a new creation. Why did God create humanity? He created us because of who He is, abounding in love. John Tillery sings, God of all creation.
God of all creation, we exalt your name. God of all creation, we magnify your name. You are high and lifted up, your train fills this temple. God of all creation, we exalt your name. Everybody say,
God of all creation.
God of all creation, you are the Prince of Peace. You are high and lifted up, and your train fills this temple. God of all creation, we exalt your name.
above the sky, beyond the sea, 'cause you died for me. We bless your name, heaven and earth proclaim, Lord, you reign. We exalt your name, we lift you high, above the sky.
Some music from the world of Southern Gospel coming up. And what else can we say about God's love? Well, I guess it's simply wonderful. Here's Greater Vision.
While down here you travel, you may never have a lot of silver and a lot of gold. Troubles overtake you and your friends may forsake you and leave you here to weep alone. But we can call on Jesus, we know that he sees us in our every trying hour. From the windows up above, he sends us his love and he keeps it with his heavenly power. Oh, I'm persuaded to believe nothing could separate us from the wonderful love of God. Home above he will give us if we let him live within us while in the sinful world we trod. Neither height nor depth, nor principalities, things present nor things to come. Though the devil hate us, he can never separate us from the wonderful love of God.
You never be a doubter. Come on and be a shouter. Take a hold of the Master's hand. Because his love is wider and it's higher than the sky or anything that's made by man. When troubles may depress you, his love will caress you. Roll your heavy burdens all away. With a loving arm, his strength and long suffering, he will lengthen. That'll keep you till the judgment day.
Oh, I'm persuaded to believe nothing could separate us from the wonderful love of God. Home above, he will give us if we let him live within us while in this sinful world we trod. Neither height nor depth, nor principality, things present nor things to come. Though the devil hate us, he can never separate us from the wonderful love of God.
Oh, I'm persuaded to believe nothing could separate us from the wonderful love of God.
Home above, he will give us if we let him live within us while in this sinful world we trod. Neither height nor depth, no principality, things present, no things to come.
wonderful love of God.
And a few words from Stubborn Love to personalize that even more. God loves me.
Gave the rippling stream as it flows through the mountain on its way to the sea. And I love the song God gave the birds to sing.
Oh, but most of all, I love the way God loves me. Most of all, I love the way God loves me. God's shown His love in so many ways. He surrounds us with His beauty each and every day. And when I am discouraged, thinking all is lost, I'm reminded of the One who died on the cross. I love the way God sends a gentle breeze, soft as a whisper, filled with peace. And I love the way God rules this world with ease. Oh, but most of all, I love the way God loves me. I love the song God gave the birds to sing. I love the way God sends a gentle breeze. I love the way God rules this world with ease. I love the grace that spans eternity. Oh, but most of all, I love the way, 'cause He loves me. He loves me. My God loves me.
You know, it was in fact the author of Lamentations who wrote, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They're new every morning." A good reminder of that from the Collingsworths.
Yes, I'm saved by mercy and love, cleansed by the power of precious blood. Sweet salvation from up above.
Most often a hymn text has a story behind it as to how it was inspired by a life event or an inspiration because of God's provision or faithfulness. When it comes to poems or hymns written by Charles Wesley, so many don't have such a story. He was always writing them, but afterwards he had few dramatic tales to tell about the occasion. It was said of Charles that he had inherited his gift from his father, and although the skill had been resident in him early in life, his conversion unlocked it and set it free. His journals say little about his composing. It seems he had within him a treasury of poetry. His mind instinctively invested words with harmony, and hymn after hymn flowed from his pen. A friend tells of many times, even when Charles was nearly 80, while riding his little pony, he would jot down his thoughts on a card that he kept in his pocket. Arriving at his friend's house and leaving his pony in the front garden, he would enter the house crying out, "Pen and ink! Pen and ink!" Once those were supplied, he would write down the composition he had been working on in his mind. Looking through a hymn book, you will often see Charles Wesley's name, but the actual number of hymns he wrote is really only estimated. Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, remains a favorite of many. It reminds us that, because God is love, He expresses His love to each of us. As you listen to Charles' wonderful hymn, may you know that God loves you.
Love divine, all loves excelling, joy of heaven to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, all thy faithful mercies crown. Jesus, thou art all compassion, pure unbounded love thou art. Visit us with thy salvation, enter every trembling heart.
Breathe, oh breathe, thy loving spirit into every troubled breast. Let us all in thee inherit, let us find the promised rest. Take away our love of sinning, Alpha and Omega be. End of faith as its beginning, set our hearts at liberty. Come, Almighty, to deliver, let us all thy grace receive. Suddenly return and never, nevermore thy temples leave. Thee would we be always blessing, serve thee as thy hosts above. Pray and praise thee without ceasing, glory in thy perfect love.
What a wonderful truth, to know that God loves you, and because of that, He made you. That changes everything, doesn't it? More information and teaching is available through our website at lightandlife.ca. That is the letters L-I-G-H-T, the letter N, and the letters L-I-F-E.ca. Hope Today is developed through the mission of Light and Life Programming, a registered Canadian charity and a listener-supported ministry. It is produced at Straight Path Studio. We look forward to being with you next time for another program of Faith and Hope. Until then, keep looking ahead. Jesus is coming again.